been. And tonight we are continuing this series that we're going to wrap up tonight, Ruth. Jumping in on the last chapter, this little short story. It's a story of hope, but it's nestled in a kind of a season, a time in history in God's people of Israel that is a straight train wreck. It is just a dark, dark time in the life and times of God's people. And this is a glimmer of hope in the midst of that. And so if you've been with us, we've kind of unpacked how hope can be seen in these various forms. We've talked about how hope can be seen in suffering, how hope can be seen in providence, in the way God provides. And last week, we talked some about how God, how hope can be seen in petition. And hopefully, we've been learning some stuff along the way, no pun intended, but simply that when we're helpless, it doesn't mean that we're hopeless. That's a big truth, I think, that we can anchor our lives in. That, like, I mean, we have a lot of circumstances around us that seem quite helpless, but that doesn't mean they have to be hopeless, that God is still at work in the midst of our suffering. He's still at work in the midst of our tragedies, in the midst of the messes that we make and the messes that everybody else makes around us. And we can't control those circumstances, but we can always control our response to them. And that's huge. I think that we've seen that in the life and the character of Ruth in this story as she's leaned into suffering. It met her face to face, and she chose to step into it and lean into it instead of run from it or set up base camp in it. She leaned in. She began to trust God in a new way. If you remember in chapter 1, where she told her mother-in-law, Naomi, she's like, where you go, I'll go. I'm going to live where you live. I'm going to die where you die. Your people can be my people, and your God will be my God. She becomes a believer. She has really no evidence of why she should be, but she says, I'm in, and I'm going to go with you, and I'm going to lean in on this. And we've seen how God responds to that kind of faith, to that kind of hope, by providing providentially and intervening in all of these moments to care for Ruth and care for her mother-in-law, Naomi, who at that point is pretty bitter. She said that she went away full and she came back empty. And then you have this dude, the winnowing guy, Boaz, with one of the best names in Scripture, enters the scene and hope begins to return. God begins to work through him and hope returns to Naomi's heart, all because hope inspires hope. There's just something contagious about being around people that are hopeful. That sometimes you can feel it. And like we talked about last week, sometimes it's annoying at first because we kind of want to have our own pity parties sometimes. But once we allow our hearts to see that they have a reason to be hopeful, we can learn that a hopeful heart can change everything. A hopeful heart can change all kinds of things. Because there's a lot of times we can't see what God's doing. We can't see it, but we can trust that what he's doing, it's for our good. And so Ruth, in this moment, is about to get married. All right, Naomi's heart posture is now hopeful, and Boaz is giving us an example of how God loves us. And so we can see that in how laser-focused he is on redeeming Ruth. His focus is Ruth's redemption, and that's where we find ourselves tonight. And so we're going to be reading some of this story. We're in chapter 4 of the book of Ruth. If you don't know where that is, if you go towards the beginning of your Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth. So it's towards the front end, but it's so tiny. I mean, it takes you less than 20 minutes to read the whole thing, so you can miss it. I'm reading from the NIV 1984 version. Here we go. Pick it up in verse 1. It says, meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat there. When the kinsman redeemer he had mentioned came along, Boaz said, come over here, my friend, and sit down. So he went over and sat down. Boaz took 10 of the elders of the town and said, sit here. And they did so. Then he said to the kinsman redeemer, Naomi, who has come back from Moab, is selling the piece of land that belonged to our brother Elimelech. I love these names. I thought I should bring the matter to your attention and suggest that you buy it in the presence of these seated here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, do so. But if you will not, tell me, so I will know. For no one has the right to do it except you, and I am next in line. I will redeem it, he said. Then Boaz said, on the day you buy the land from Naomi and from Ruth, the Moabitess, I love that. Crazy words here. You acquire the dead man's widow in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property. At this, the kinsman redeemer said, then I cannot redeem it because I might endanger my own estate. You redeem it yourself. I cannot do it. Now, in earlier times in Israel, for the redemption and transfer of property to become final, one party took off his sandal and gave it to the other. That's so cool. This was the method of legalizing transactions in Israel. Think about like just making a purchase at Target, you know, and you're just like, oh, hey, yeah, and you give your sandal. Sorry, you guys are like, that doesn't make sense, but it's awesome. So the kinsman redeemer said to Boaz, buy it yourself, and he removed his sandal. Then Boaz announced to the elders and all the people, today you are my witnesses that I have bought from Naomi all the property, Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon. I've also acquired Ruth, the Moabitess, Mahlon's wife, as my wife, in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property, so that his name will not disappear from among his family or from the town records. Today you are my witnesses. Okay. So they're at the town gates, and I love how, like, in the end of chapter 3, if you remember, if you were with us last week, the last verse of chapter 3 says, then Naomi said, wait, my daughter, until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled today. And the next verse says, meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat there. I love that. It's like, he will not rest. And then he just sits down. Now there's a lot to do with it. Like, and in like the first few verses, like everybody's sitting. Everybody, here, sit down. I think that's funny. You don't. But the reason why is they're coming to the town gates. This is a place where kind of official business happens. Like we were talking about last week, that the threshing floor, the community uses this space that's shared in order to kind of tackle things for harvest. Well, the town gate, this is where official business, this is where all kinds of proceedings happen, and this unique exchange happens now. Now, what's interesting, one thing, little tangent here, maybe not too far, but like it only takes 3 elders to tackle a land deal. Whenever there's a transaction of a business of that kind of land, it only takes 3 people. He has 10. You know why he needs 10? Nobody. It's okay. Guess how many you need for a wedding? 10. Yeah, I wasn't trying to trick you, I swear. You're like, he's going to stump us. Like, he needs 10, which means Boaz is working the plan, okay? He knows exactly what he's doing. He's following through. And we don't know if Elimelech sold all this property before he bailed and went to Moab. We don't know if that's how it played out. We don't know if Naomi still has the land, and it's just in a situation where we know she doesn't have the resources to continue to develop it. She needs to eat. That's what the first 3 chapters have been about. She has nothing, absolutely nothing. Either way, she has first dibs. She has first right of refusal, no matter what the context is, even if it's the year of Jubilee. If you want to do some research on some fun stuff with that, look that up. Every 7 years, all the land would get sent back to the person who owned it before. All debts were kind of like forgotten and all kinds of crazy stuff. It was super, super cool, but very hard to keep. All right, so she has first right of refusal. Anybody ever play Monopoly? Some of you are like, yes, Monopoly, can we play right now? No, we're not playing right now. But does anybody get, like, when you're playing Monopoly, it gets heated? Anybody, like, you can be best friends until you play Monopoly together, and then you're like, I don't like you as a person anymore, right? It's very revealing of someone, right? Like, you can be like, oh, you say so surface level when Monopoly starts, and once that property is all purchased and the gloves come off, it starts to get cutthroat and ugly, doesn't it? My brother is very competitive. My wife is very sweet, but she does not like to lose. And she never really does, okay? She literally wins everything, okay? And that one time made my brother furious because, well, she was beating him, but then the tables turned. And here's what happens. What always happens in Monopoly, like when you develop one area too much and not enough in the other areas, and then you land on somebody's and it just takes one time, right? What do you have to do? You have to start mortgaging everything off, right? You have to start flipping it over. That's what happens. You flip the card over, you pay the bank, all this kind of stuff until all of your land is mortgaged. And the next thing you know, you can't really redeem it yourself. And all it is you're hoping you're going to make it another pass around, all right? And what happens? You don't. But then you just start hoping that the person you don't like is who doesn't get your property, right? Like you're hoping, like, and then me, I become the beneficiary because my wife will always make that work out. Like she'll hang on to everything so that
when she lands on my property, I get all of that so that my brother doesn't, which only breeds more hostility. But think of Monopoly. That's kind of what's happened. Someone in this situation, like everything is, it's underdeveloped. She can't provide. She can't take care of this land. It's got to be redeemed. And so this is what's happening. But the role of the kinsman redeemer, this term that keeps popping up, it's what we've been talking about all along. The role is to buy back any land that's in danger of being sold outside of the family. So this is the role of the kinsman redeemer is to step up and to make sure that everything stays together on behalf of the family. The other part of that role is to carry on the name of the dead, okay? And remember, Ruth's husband died, and she has no kids. And so the next step of this is to marry her, okay? And this is cultural stuff. This guy, he could have been Boaz's brother. More than likely, they were cousins or something like that. But he sees the potential in this. When he hears Boaz explain the first part of the scenario that, hey, there's land here, he knows that this is a small community. They know that Naomi has no sons alive. They know that she has no heirs, all right? So this guy's initial thought could very easily be, all I need to do is buy this land, and then when she passes away, I just have that much more land, and that will go to my kids, okay? And in verse 4, he's like, I'll redeem it. Dunzo, let's wrap it up. I got this. And then Boaz explains the rest of the deal that Naomi comes with, and so does Ruth. And so if you remember, we talked about in Leviticus 25 and Deuteronomy 25, this levirate law about marrying this widow and carrying on the family name. He would have been responsible for taking care of Ruth as his wife and taking her as his wife. And that means this, any son they might have had would then become the heir to that property, okay? So that's why in verse 4, he's like, deal, let's do this. Verse 5, he explains that Ruth comes with. Verse 6, he's like, hard pass, can't do it, you do it, I'm out. Right? He immediately doesn't want to do that, and it's because he's not interested in taking on that risk. He doesn't want to mess up his own portfolio. He's got this nice, neat plan of his own estate, and he recognizes that he could lose property in this. If he were to have a son with Ruth, all of that land could potentially go to this son and not the rest of his family. And so the bottom line is he wanted to protect his legacy. He was protecting his own stuff more so than being concerned about bringing redemption to the situation. And he has the same risk that Boaz does. But his refusal to assume that role, it kind of highlights how kind and how generous Boaz is. I don't think we can pick on this cat. I don't think we can blame him. It's kind of like with Orpah in chapter 1, where Naomi kept hounding and hounding and hounding, saying like, go home, go home. And she's like, no, I want to come with. And then finally she's like, okay, I'll go home, all right? I think in the same way that Orpah's decision highlighted Ruth's loyalty and Ruth's devotion, this does the same thing to capture how kind and generous Boaz is. And so love is finding a way. And I think what's funny is, like, I mean, we're all kind of rooting for Boaz anyway, right? Like we're rooting for Boaz and Ruth, this romantic comedy at this point. And they have this flip-flop sandal ceremony, which is rooted in some other crazy stuff. Like, bottom line, if somebody didn't follow through, the widow could walk up to the guy, take the sandal, and spit in their face. Let that sink in for a second. That's not always how we handle conflict right now, is it? Better not be how you handle conflict right now, right? How crazy is that? Here's what I love, though. This guy, he was so concerned about his legacy, and we don't even learn his name. Like, this guy wanted to protect his legacy. We don't even catch his name. Boaz is only concerned with his love for Ruth and redeeming her, and here we are thousands of years later talking about Boaz. How awesome of a dude he was. And I think that when we talk about legacy, it's important that we capture this. Like, legacy is a good thing, but make your legacy about redemption. Make your legacy about what you do for others more so than what your legacy is in protecting your own estates. And again, I think through this, we see God's love through Boaz. We see this expression because he doesn't have to do this. He chooses to do this. It's because he loves, and what Boaz does is he's counting the cost.
He's weighing the risk, and he finds Ruth's redemption worth it. Boaz is not just the redeemer in this story. He's the advocate in this story. Like, he goes, he's the one who goes to the town gate. He's the one that, like, that is speaking on behalf of Naomi and speaking on behalf of Ruth. Ruth is from Moab. She's a foreigner. She can't even legally convene a court. It's not even legal for her to bring everybody together. He's not just a redeemer. He's an advocate. And it's because Boaz is restoring a family, and he's even raising the name of the dead publicly. And we see continually this picture of Christ's relationship with us, those that belong to him, those that trust him. We can see this expressed through Boaz. And so I want to highlight some things that we can learn just about Boaz in this moment, about this kinsman redeemer, this concept. Markers of a redeemer is what I would say. And the first one is this: you have to be related. To be a kinsman redeemer, you have to be related. That's what brings this all together. Boaz was related. He wasn't the nearest in relation, but he was related. And the question I have is, like, can you see Jesus in that? And initially, maybe you can't. But when you begin to see who Jesus is, think of it this way. Jesus related to us before he redeemed us. If you look at Hebrews 2, 14 and 15, it says that he became flesh and blood so that he could die for us on the cross. He related to us. He stepped into humanity so that he could redeem us. I think we can see Jesus in that. So the first one is you have to be related. The second one is that you got to be able to pay the redemption price. You have to be able to afford to pay the redemption price. Ruth and Naomi, they couldn't pay for anything. They couldn't afford to redeem the property. They couldn't afford to redeem themselves. Boaz had all the resources necessary. And again, the question is, can you see Jesus in this? Can you see Jesus in this? There's a truth I think you can take home is simply this, that only Jesus has what it takes to pay the price to redeem sinners. Only Jesus has what it takes to pay the price to redeem sinners. 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19 says that it's not with perishable things. Not with perishable things that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. I think if we're honest, which isn't always easy, we're really in the same boat as Ruth and Naomi. We may think we have it all figured out, but really we're poor in so many ways. Sometimes our poverty, we think in terms of finances or resources or stuff. Sometimes our poverty is expressed in everything else. Always it's expressed spiritually. Always. We're poor. We have nothing to offer. We cannot pay back what we owe. But we have redemption through Jesus because he gave himself for us. Third thing would be this, the marker of a redeemer. You had to be willing to redeem. So you had to be related. You had to be able to afford the redemption price, but you had to be willing to pay the redemption price. There's a difference between having the ability to and choosing to. It's called love. You had to be willing to redeem. Boaz counted the cost, and he found Ruth worth it. And once again, I'm asking the question, can you see Jesus in this? Because Jesus counted the cost and he found you worth it. And that may be all you need to hear tonight. Because maybe you've kind of been functioning a whole different wavelength that says, maybe I'm not worth it. Maybe the choices I make aren't worth it. And you'll begin to interpret all the interactions with other people completely differently. I want you to hear me. There can be no redemption without paying the price. There can be no redemption without paying the price. And it cost God everything so that he could give it to us for free. There can be no redemption without paying the price. This nearer kinsman redeemer, he was trying to protect his name. He was trying to protect his inheritance. And Boaz took the risk of love, took the risk of obedience. I think that's why we know his name. That's why we can see the picture of Jesus in his choices, because he wasn't concerned about jeopardizing his inheritance. Instead, he made us a part of his inheritance. Can you see the difference in that? In Ephesians 1, maybe it's worth writing down verse 18, where Paul is praying that our hearts would be enlightened, our eyes would be opened to know the hope to which he's called us. The riches of his glorious inheritance. Jesus has made us his inheritance. And maybe you got an idea of how poor you are. Maybe you've invested a lot in trying to win him back. Maybe you've invested a lot in trying to bring everything you got to try and get God to like you a little bit. And maybe the reality is you just need to stop looking for what's already found you. If your investments, the steps you take, are to try and convince God to like you when he already loves you, you're working for the wrong thing. Because you're not working from love, you're working for love. There's a huge difference. And some of us, maybe that's where we find ourselves, where we're trying different things simply because we don't know what else to try. Because we're so conditioned to earn everything else that we have. Maybe, though, you know you have nothing to offer. Maybe you feel reminded of that in a lot of your choices. Maybe it's because you've read this enough to know that anything we set before God is not good enough, but he loves us anyway. Maybe it's time to let our hearts rest there. Either way, there can be no redemption without paying the price, and Jesus paid it all for you. Redemption comes at a cost, and it's huge, so that we can experience salvation for free. My hope, that's why I can sing songs, like my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And sometimes when you start talking about blood in church, everybody's like, what are you talking about? My hope is made complete in Christ. Nothing else will complete and satisfy that hope. Let's keep reading. Verse 11, this is what we learn. It says, then the elders and all those at the gate said, we are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. May you have standing in Ephrathah and be famous in Bethlehem. Through the offspring the Lord gives you by this young woman, may your family be like that of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah. All right, more names, more story that goes with all of them. But here's what's happening. The plan is coming together. This is the wedding part. The land deal, all of this stuff has already happened. This is the wedding part. And you're like, that's a fast ceremony, right? Everybody been to a wedding and the preacher guy asks the question, like, if anyone objects, like, speak now or for what? Forever hold your peace. Have you heard that in weddings? Have you heard anyone not forever hold their peace and they speak up? Awkward. Yes, that is the word. Like, if you want to have your heart kind of turn in a bunch of different directions, just YouTube that and you will come across some people that chose to object in those moments. Okay? Sorry to even bring that up. For those of you that might be getting married this next year, I don't know. This is their moment to say, no, we are not on board for this. This is their moment. This is the townspeople. This is the community. These are family people. These are elders. This is their moment to say, no, no deal. I don't like where this is going. But they respond with blessing. They reference Rachel and Leah. Rachel's buried not far from where they're at, talking about making to be made famous in Bethlehem, and they're affirming this. They're celebrating this. Ruth has placed her trust in Boaz. And to this point, we've seen so many things completely change course simply because she put her hope in him. And we've seen loneliness turn to love and stress and anxiety and worry and suffering turn to assurance. We've seen crisis move to a place of peace and every reason to despair move to a place of hope. No longer is Ruth the Moabitess. She's like Ruth the Boazitess. No, probably not. Just wife of Boaz, okay? Like, you're like, is that real? No, I just made that up, okay? Like, she's now not known as being from Moab. This is Ruth, the wife of Boaz. This is a new beginning. So something I think we can grab a hold of is this. Hope brings new beginnings. Hope always brings new beginnings. So maybe the question for you is, where do you need a new beginning? Where do you need a new beginning? What in your life needs restoration right now? Maybe it's a friendship that used to be great, and for whatever reason, right now, it's not. Maybe it's some family relationship where things are not healthy, and somebody's got to say something. Maybe it's a relationship lost. Maybe it's a relationship you thought you had. There's so many different settings, but my question is, where do you need a new beginning? Will you let hope lead you there? Let's take a look at this last stretch. 13, pick it up in verse 13. It says, so Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. Then he went to her, and the Lord enabled her to conceive. That's a whole other sermon series, okay? She gave birth to a son. The woman said to Naomi, praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer. May he become famous throughout Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you and who is better to you than seven sons, has given him birth. Then Naomi took the child, laid him in her lap, and cared for him. The women living there said, Naomi has a son, and they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. Stop there. Okay. Gets married, makes a baby. Baby's a boy. His name is Obed. A lot's happened in just a handful of verses, okay? I mean, that's like, well, at least 9 months, okay? So just in a handful, if you're counting. But in verse 14, they say, praise be to the Lord. Like, they're focused on celebrating. Like, and when they say that, like, God has not left you helpless. He's given you a kinsman redeemer. He's given you someone to provide. They're not talking about Boaz. They're talking about Obed. They've got a bigger picture here. They're talking about the baby, this blessing, and talking about becoming famous and renewing life and sustaining, and that having Ruth in your life is better than having seven sons. And what they're saying is, like, the full blessing of family. Seven is a number of completion. And having a son is a big deal because it carries on the name. And what they're saying is, like, Ruth is better than having all that. The reason why is because Ruth has helped Naomi find hope again. And here we have love finding a way. And I think something about this that we can be reminded of, not all stories have a happy ending. This seems pretty happy, but here's what we can be reminded of. God still writes the last chapter. Hearts that were empty are now full. The story opens with funerals, and it ends with a wedding and a baby. God still writes the last chapter, and I think maybe what we can glean from this is that God still cares for us, even when we are bitter towards him. Even when you are upset with him, even when you are pouring forth all kinds of venom towards him, He still cares for you. He took a new believer in Ruth and directed her steps. He used her faith and obedience to transform everything. She completely flipped the script. This story could have ended so much sooner and went a completely different direction. But God cares about the details of our lives, and maybe right now you don't feel like that's true. And maybe you have found yourself mad. He can handle it. And maybe you've been trying to take the pen out of his hands to write the next chapter. And maybe you need to let him lead. This hope we've been hanging on to, it leads to redemption. Hope leads to rejoicing. Something to think about would simply be this. Who are the people you're surrounding yourself with? Are they the people that will stand with you when your heart is breaking and bitterness is making a run for your heart? Are they the same people that are ready to celebrate with you when God brings restoration? Because this is the inevitable end of hope. It leads to redemption. It leads to rejoicing. But don't miss this. Hope reminds us our King is coming. Hope reminds us our King is coming. This genealogy where it starts rattling off all these names that are kind of hard to pronounce, it leads to David. But it ultimately ends with Jesus. David is who God brought into this picture to bring peace and restoration to his people, Israel. But God brings Jesus into the mix to bring peace to all people. And you see prophecy fulfilled in this. And that's why Bethlehem is such a big deal. Messianic prophecy all throughout Scripture. That's why David, the line of David, is such a big deal. That's why tying everything back to Judah is such a big deal. So the next time you hold a baby, maybe just think for a second, like, wow, what might God do with you? Because my guess is all of your parents were doing the same thing with you. Some of you are like, they do that with me right now. Like, they just put me on their lap and it's awkward. And they're like, what are we going to do with you, right? But now think about it. Like, I know for you guys, some of you, you don't realize this, but I don't know how to shut the dad off in me. And I tell you, honestly, my family prays for all of you guys all the time. There's not much sweeter than a 3-year-old praying for return people or a 9-year-old praying for so many of you by name or an 11-year-old doing the same thing. It's because they love you. They don't even know you completely. Some of you they know well. Some of you they've not even met you, but they're praying for you. And it's because their daddy loves you. And it's because I don't know how to shut the dad off in me. And what I'm getting at is this, like, I have hopes for you. Now, I don't want you to think about sitting in my lap, okay? This is not Christmas time. I'm not Santa. You're not going to sit in my lap. And I'm like, I have hopes for you. I'm telling you right now, I have hopes for you. And I pray those hopes over you all the time. You have no idea what God intends to do with you. But I'm telling you, if you are willing to step into that story, you will begin to see all that he hopes to be for you and to you. And he will use you. Don't settle. Don't settle for hoping for small things. Get by week to week or season to season or job to job or semester to semester or even relationship to relationship. Hope always looks for the long game. Hope always looks for the long game, and hope reminds us of our King that is coming. Hope is a certain expectation. That's literally the definition. And you can be certain of this. God is good, and he's at work for your good. And we see that in Jesus. Don't hang out in chapter 2 living on leftovers when he's called you to live in chapter 4. Don't settle for just the gifts from God. Seek communion with God. But always come back to this. You got to put yourself at his feet. Let me pray. Father, Again, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the privilege it is to gather in this space, in this time, on this night. We pray that you would use our time in groups to challenge our hearts, to nudge our hearts, to help us see you more clearly, to help us know one another more fully, so that we can serve one another and encourage one another and challenge one another and lock arms with one another as we come after you. We love you and we trust you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.